Yeah, hi, I'm Gerald, and I think for those of you who've just come in, we're straight in from, well, talking about Dark Dot, and then looking at some really awesome games that were made by, some really awesome movie game ideas, like Near Far, Wherever You Are, like a game about lying, and like a game about source code. Oh, he's not here. But yes, we had plenty of those. So this, my session's really about wrapping up. And hang on. Yes. Okay. So we'll see how far we go with the flow of the Skinner box. What I originally intended was to talk a bit about psychology, but just to move on slightly, what I do at Gambit right now, of course I cover the operations side of Gambit, but as far as I don't design games as much anymore, but I work with the designers so that they understand motivation, triggers, and they understand the psychology of design. Just a bit of my background as well. I started out with an Australian studio doing work for hire. I managed the studio and the business side of things. We grew really fast. I got tired, so I started playing lots of poker and did that for a couple of months, which is quite cool. It's good to know when to hold and when to fold, right? So then I worked for the government in Singapore and funding game companies, and that's where I met my my partner in this game called Toribash, which we built up from nothing to, well, from 5,000 users to today there's about 1.2 million of them. And of course Gambit, where I'm responsible for operating the studio. So, and I'd just like to thank a few people. You've met Roland, you've met Justin as well. That's a very flattering shot of Justin. And Hampus, my ex-partner, and some of the players from Toribash who actually supported us in the growing process for the game. So, like I said, I was originally going to talk about psychology. I was going to talk about the Skinner box, and I was going to talk about using reward schedules to design for certain behavioral outcomes, and how using meshing the theory of flow together with the Skinner box would shape player outcomes and shape behavioral outcomes. But I'm not a psychologist, right? So I'm probably not the best person to talk about it. But I think what I can share with you from my experience is using my understanding of motivation and reinforcement to build a game, and how we build a culture from out of a very simple game. And I'd say it's extended beyond a game, it's just play. So Toribash came about as a concept. Hampus was a judo black belt champion, and it was really about understanding what fighting is really like, right? And what fighting really is about is fighting, if any of you do martial arts, fighting is really about analyzing different moments and seeing how your body reacts to these moments. So if you look at it, the Toribash concept was very much inspired by this, the micro moments of fighting and how you react to them. It also involved fighting also involves the understanding of the body, right? The understanding of body mechanics, body kinetics, kinesthetics, yeah. So how the body functions and how the body moves. So So I'm going to talk to you a bit today about how we used our understanding of these concepts, our understanding of different motivations, and how we grew a community of players from 5,000 to 1.2 million using a game client, a forum, and YouTube. It's a 7 megabyte game download. So now this is what Toribash looks like in its simplest form. So we start off by, I'm going to show you a bit of how it works. So where is my... Oh, sorry. What am I doing? I don't know. Okay. Okay, so with Toribash, what happens is it's all about understanding the body, right? So if you look at this, and it's about manipulating joints through different states. If we are to use the verb example, it really is about, at the core of Toribash, it is you are exerting force on a joint, which we have here. If you look at the ghost of the character, okay, so this is what happens, and this is what happens when the body is relaxed. You see the ghost moving downwards, right? It's sort of slack. And what happens when you do certain things, that you exert force? See, my character is sort of pushing the chest out like that. So that's extending the joint. And what happens when you contract the joint? It's slapping these two together, right? So at the heart of Toribash, it really is about understanding the combination of different movements of joints create movement. So you see, my character's just moved. Let me take you through another example. I will take you through how to. Should I do this first, or should I? Should I cover the boring stuff first, or should I just show you how to dismember something? What do people want? I don't know. Dismember or understanding the mechanics, technical stuff? I don't know. Oh, who's for technical stuff? Oh, okay. That one. I'll show how to dismember, and hopefully I get it right. It's been a while. It's been about 2 years. So, okay, let's see. I am doing this. I'm doing this to generate force, right? So I'm also moving the ankles to generate some sort of force like this. And then I am doing this. I am also generating some sort of movement like this, right? So in this, I'm sweeping off his feet. Oh shit, I might fail. This is not good. I am failing for a presentation. Okay. Okay, so let's see if we move forward. Okay, I hope I've got this right. And then... Okay. Oh, I'm doing something there that I'm not sure what I'm doing. But I didn't... Okay, so yes, what I meant to do was I wanted to kick this joint off. But I haven't done this in a while. So you can see my level of mastery has actually gone down quite a bit. So anyway, moving back, I will hopefully show a dismemberment movement later on. I'm apparently not as good as I used to be. So going back to the presentation. Yes, so going back to this, the core of it is understanding movement, right? So the next bit is... So when does understanding movement become play? Understanding movement becomes play when you move different joints within the body, right? Move different joints within the body, and you create different movements. So that really is play. When it becomes a competition is when I'm actually playing against somebody else, right? And that actually, then we have game rules that come in. And the game rules that come in are that within a certain number of frames, you saw that I was forwarding frames, that I would disqualify someone by pushing them out of the ring or by dealing them more damage, right? Dealing them more damage by dismembering them, or, well, we can kick heads off in Toribash, as you saw. We can also kick crotches, which I did accidentally. But yeah, so... Accidentally, yeah. For the Wii version, I actually made a video where you could technically jump up and with enough force use the... Why am I doing this in the present? You could use the pelvic region to decapitate someone. Yeah, so we did that video for the Wii launch of Toribash. Anyway, so if you analyze it, the... Now I'm trying to sound all academic. It is a bit like chess, right? Because in chess, you are choosing a piece. You are reading your opponent's move, and then you are moving, which is similar to what we had in Toribash. You are, first you make a move, you read what your opponent is doing, and we denote that by the ghost which you saw. That's the prediction of my motion in future, and so I'm countering that with my opponent. So that's what we did. Now, you will also note that we had, my inability now to dismember someone's, leg, that we had quite a bit of a learning curve. If you download it, you'll realize that. Because there's several levels of mastery that are going on, right? You're mastering body kinesthetics. You're also understanding how joints work. And you're understanding how to manipulate these, if you go to the online version, how to manipulate these joints over 15 seconds, which creates this time constraint. You're like, oh shit, I have to. Anyway, so that creates this tension within you. And then it was really interesting to see how people would make the character run. So that itself is a huge thing. But anyway, in spite of this, what we realized was that we built in some sort of progression, and we realized that once we kept people for 14 days, because there was a certain level of mastery involved, once they had mastered that, they were locked in. And that sweet spot was really 14 days. And that sweet spot was about 100 fights, because they'd done enough. Of course, we did different things along the way to enhance that, because we did a lot of data collection, and then we did strategies to even out the learning curve. I guess when you see Toribash, there's this thing where it goes to Toribash violence perfected. So simply having this thing where you're just beating someone wasn't really enough for us. When you're dismembering something, or when something splits off from the body, you really need some cues, right? So if we let's do this side by side. I think it works better. So if we are, so you can see that moment when it happens, and then you can understand that feeling you get, right? Okay. So, if we are to, so say you're doing the game and you're forwarding frames. I'm just doing this bit by bit. You can hack so that you can do this. So the point where you dismember, one, that crack, that's that positive reinforcement audio cue. That shit, I've done something awesome, right? And then what happens after that? I'm running this on low settings, so you're not seeing. We have higher settings where the blood is a bit more real. You realize that everything's more real. So that whole blood thing where the blood starts spurting out. Let's see if I can change the so high if it will accept it. Okay, so we have a bit more of a realistic blood effect of the blood flying off. All right. Can change my camera point of view, and you can see this blood, and then that really seals it for players, right? Because you have this thing that's coming out when you've done something awesome and you've learned you've figured out how to move, and then shit, I've done something awesome, right? So that's what really happened with Toribash, and players started. You have unexpected outcomes, so players started painting with their blood splatters, and players aim to dismember more. And then, all right, so this one happened a bit before, but we realized that we had a fight replay system, which we used. So every fight was saved into a replay. And what happened after that was that, you're having this loop again. So what you saw just then of the character jumping up and kicking the head off, that was a replay, right? But that also serves to reinforce you that you can go back and revisit that move, and it feels good. So everything is enforced, reinforces that visual. You notice we kept environments simple. That was deliberate. Also, because the cost of doing environments, come on, right? So but that reinforced the visual as well, so we tried to keep that simple. So, and doing this fight replay system, actually, one was that it reinforced the primal thing, but when you have this concept of doing a replay, people kind of then get the concept, hey, I'm actually doing a fight scene. So they try to recreate different fight scenes that they found awesome in the game. So, like, Chun-Li spinning bird kick. I don't know why they called it that. But spinning bird kick was... So they would try different moves to replicate different things. Things that they saw in martial arts movies, things that they saw in other games, they would try to replicate it here. Because Toribash was the game where they had full control over the body. Whereas in other fighting games, you're pressing a button and that creates a response. That's different, right? Of course, there's an argument against that. That says the game flow of Toribash is different because just the structure of the game is different. But then something intelligent that we did was we had a forum for fans together and all that. So we enabled players to upload replays to the forum. And that's really simple. So just before all of this, this was when Facebook was still really early, so it's 2008. So once they were uploading stuff to the forum, there's a few things that happened there. There's community validation. Hey, shit, you're doing a cool move. So what do you do? And this, we could have done this better, but players would... We actually improved it later where the replays get automatically streamed to your client in the background. So players could then see what other players did, and then they could rate them up on the forum. I like this replay, I didn't like this replay, and why. I kind of ran out of right now I'm trying to make it pretty and try to do some visuals around this, but let's see what. So right now I'm just going to focus on the combination of things that worked for us. But I wanted to show you something quickly on what. What the effect of letting players upload or just enabling players, giving players the ability to upload stuff on the forum and having community validation, because sometimes they get a bit wacky and this happens. So you get the idea, right? This is the players, so you might clap for the players because they're the ones who made it, and we just made it possible. So, but the thing to take away from this thing is, I think that once you enable the concept of play, and you just let people play with stuff, you come up with crazy things. So, yeah. Getting back to. All right. So what did we do? Right. And I will show you another video in a second. But what we did was we let players upload stuff to the forums, and we had this background downloading happening. But modding was So keeping the client light. So we had community reinforcement and all that. Then. Having the fight replay system, like you saw, that was really useful. What we then did later was we enabled players to automatically convert the replay file into a video. So that set the context for, I'm going to upload it to YouTube, right? And what then happened there was that within a period of 3 months, we had, 1,000 videos on YouTube of just fight moves and fight scenes and players uploading stuff. So I think that giving them the opportunity to create something, that worked out for us in that worked out really well for us. So the next thing that we really invested in was building the mod community. It's amazing what you can do with blocks, spheres, and cylinders and joints, and I'll show you an example of that later. But that really is like doing that, you kind of have to seed modding, you have to see this creation of stuff, right? So we had a community mod team of 10 players who really liked the game, were big fans of it. So we ran monthly themes, and these are kind of like game jams, right? If we made modding easy enough, well, people come to it, and if we do it together, they feel this vested interest. So we ran a couple of these. I think today there are about 3,000 different mods from Toribash. Not responsible for sorting that. It's hard to sort them, but at least that capability is available. And so what this then sets is a continuous culture of extended play, right? So the culture of play extends beyond the original game rules that you defined for it. So I'll show you a video. let me show you a video of Combos Mods. This one. Oh, okay. Is it happening? Yeah, there's the standard stuff of people liking to dismember stuff, but the modding part comes later. So they kind of started playing with stuff. So you must remember that the game rules here, yeah, it's a bit light on the game rules, but people are playing. And the main thing is that you're engaging players through play, right? Yeah, what this was, I have no idea. Why did it happen? I don't know. But it happens, which is cool. And it's inspiration for if you want to take it further. And you can set force on objects, so you have this momentum going. Yeah. Yeah, so, and this is a player-made video as well, so. You will actually get to see more awesome stuff that came out from the mod community later. But, yes, so. What is it like, right? So yes, we did the whole thing that we did with replays to mods as well. You can upload them and you can share them and rate them and all that. So the modders actually had followings in their own right, right? Because I won't call them game designers, I just call them play designers, and they have their own following, fan base, which is awesome. So just to run through some mods, we had, we built environments like tables, so you know, you could smash players into them. That created more positive reinforcement for breaking environments apart. Then you had this, David Goliath moment. You're fighting in a cage. You have chickens. I don't know what the chickens are doing. I have no idea. But yeah, people made them, and that's the important thing, right? And I think the one thing that we did really well after together with modding was. Helped promote modding was this whole culture of video making and this whole culture of getting people to upload stuff on YouTube. I think that was important. So for us, we were running like monthly competitions to have monthly video competitions to have people upload stuff on YouTube. So what would happen is that, okay, you'd have a monthly mod theme. So players would make a mod. Then they would make awesome replays of these mods, right? And then they will make a video of it and post it on YouTube. So you have this continuous cycle of stuff going on. And it's a whole chain, and it keeps happening. So today, I think there's 13,000 videos of Toribash on YouTube, and you will see. And because you create that momentum of themes, players run with it themselves, and then they create their own themes because they're inspired. And yeah, so you see some of that later. So where did this all end up, right? So we grew from about 50,000 to about 200,000 plus players over 2008. Later on, In 2009, I think we hit about 800,000, something like that. But you'd see that at the activity side, it's not so high. But that's the one is the natural attrition. But the other thing is also it's that level of mastery. Not that many players aspire to anyway, and that's a natural attrition rate that we saw. So I'm going to show you a series of videos right now. One to show you how Toribash existed as a fighting play kind of tool in a fighting game. And the second thing I'm going to show you is an evolution of that, where players playing with environments and characters, and players coming up with their own game rules. And the last thing that I'm going to show you is something I never even expected. So let's watch what happens. Okay, so this is, we took this, we did like a video with the community, 2008. So you can see how we were playing with different themes as well, right? So how you get from something hardcore and something that, you know, really grips you like that, how you get from that to this, I don't really know, but it happens. So 16 objects that you can play with. Players ended up building a skate park and a skateboard where they started playing around with this. There's no set game rules, but what then happened was they created skate competitions, right? And so the goal was to upload the best replay and do the best video, which would then be rated by the community, and then as skate competitions go, right? So this is what happened. And this would be mastery of balance. A lot of this mod was in setting up your initial body configuration and then just riding it out, sometimes with little tweaks along the way, because you can control 20 joints, so it's a bit like real life skating. Yeah. And you can do tricks. And the last thing that I'm going to show you is we had a Russian contingent of players that were really hardcore. They were doing everything from a mobile game to achievements, which we then incorporated into the main achievement. Yeah, the body became a race car, right? So we're like, what's happening here? We had no idea. And how you control the race car is like how you set up joints. The wheels were the joints, so if you extended it, it would go into a really fast forward motion. If you set contract, it would go into a really fast backward motion. And there were no set game rules for this as well. This was just play. And they would just be playing in the servers. So, and yeah, I forgot to mention that as much as they could upload, so they could upload these mods, they would also, we had game servers, right, as you do, game servers, game lobbies and all of that. We allowed the players to set up different game mods on the server so they could play together. So, if you think the underlying thing is that I think what we really did was that we understood player motivation really well. And sometimes it is just to play. Sometimes it is just to play, but reinforcing that loop is important. And reinforcing it, visual cues, audio cues, but also reinforcing it with the strategies that you use as a company, that's really, really important. So we actually had, and we were quite surprised with this, but we had a community team of about 60 people. 60 volunteers in Toribash who are all about just building the game and building the game in their countries and localizing and all that stuff, which was really, really awesome. So what started out for us as we were building a game kind of evolved into something where we realized we were actually building some kind of culture. And we were actually, it's something that we never really intended for, but it just happened along the way. So I'm going to, this was from the Russian contingent, which I'm just really thankful for. But you also realize that this was what happened with a similar game, but we were earlier. Just saying. So yeah, that's it. That's all. So yeah, thank you. Any questions?
Which show again is that player data?
Which one? A player data? There's more activity data, so there's several levels down that we went into. How they progressed, why they progressed, what servers they were going into, why were they doing that, what the expected lifespan of the user was, would the expected lifespan be, what activities, what verbs do they think they'll be doing, so what core activities were they doing, and then we would go back and track why weren't they doing it, and then we would test, we would test a lot. I think we had at one point, we're doing monthly releases. So I mean that for a game client is quite often. Yeah, we're trying to do testing every 2 to 3 weeks. So we did things also like we established a we realized that beginners weren't going through enough, so we did a fight bot that would help them when they were fighting. And then we also tunneled them through the forum. We had the beginner area so that they would get to know each other, identify with each other, and then kind of grow in the community together. And then we did clan structures and all of that.
Thank you.
Yeah. Anything? That's it? Any other questions? I don't know. No, oh yeah. So. Yeah, it's you.
No, I was curious about your 3D model in the area. Yes. Points of articulation.
There's 20 points of articulation. Yeah. I was going to say, you want to come try it? You want to try to play it?
I think I might not stop.
Okay. Because I'm scared. What if he doesn't get it? Then, okay, no. Yeah. Any other questions? No? Videos, fighting, body motion, dismember. Okay. I guess we'll wrap then. Thank you.